200 or Jeff at RoxburyWineAndSpirit.com. This is WIOX, Roxbury, Delhi, Andes, Downsville, Margaretville, Arkville, Stamford, Grand Gorge, Middleburg, Schoharie, Pine Hill, Fleischmann's, Bovina, Hobart, Halkettsville, Halkett Center, Prattsville, Bloomville, and Big Indian.
Okay, you're listening to WIOX Community Radio, live and local in the Catskill Mountains at 91.3 FM and MTC Cable Channel 20, and everywhere at wioxradio.org, where it's easy to donate if you like what you hear. You can also get WIOX on any smart device through the radio.fm app. This is From the Forest, every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m. Talk about a different forest-related topic with Ryan and John. John, how's it going?
Things are good, Ryan. Fall's here.
It's beautiful weather. It's absolutely gorgeous out there.
Oh, man. You can do anything outside now. I back to cutting firewood again.
Did you?
Not for mine. Somebody else's.
Oh.
Mine's long been done.
Yeah. That's cool. Yeah, it's beautiful outside. I love it. I noticed the tippy tops of my red maples are starting to turn red, so
yep.
That's cool.
Yeah, I've seen that around, too.
Yeah.
Some of the sugar maple are getting that little bit of a tinge to them.
Yep.
That little orange before they go that bright yellow color, golden color.
Absolutely. So, deer hunting season is coming. Bow hunting season begins October 1st. Bear hunting season is right now? Still? I think so. 27th?
Yeah,
still maybe?
I think it's closing soon, yeah.
Yeah.
It's open. It was open.
Yeah. So that's something.
Squirrels open.
Yeah. Squirrels open.
Those big squeehaw hunters.
Squeehaw hunters. Yeah. Squirrel hunting. You been squirrel hunting, John?
Not really. I've carried a gun with me going for walks in the woods, and maybe if I saw a squirrel, I don't know.
Yeah,
sure. Squirrels are good, man. You ever had a squirrel?
Years ago.
You do a squirrel. Squirrel legs. Quarter them up. Just any like quarter, but
Yeah,
cook them the same as chicken wings, man.
Dime them up,
and it's just like eating a chicken wing off the bone. You just rip and tear.
I would imagine so. They eat nuts and stuff, all good food.
No, they're good.
So, I'm hearing that the spotted lanternfly is at our border. So,
where?
Pennsylvania, I guess. Zane, who works with the Catskill Forest Association, was right on the border of New York buying a truck and saw the spotted lanternfly.
Oh boy!
Yeah.
And I also saw an article that EHD is in
Ulster County.
Ulster County?
Yeah.
Or at least in Orange County.
I think it's in Ulster.
Boy, that's not good.
Yeah. But, it doesn't spread to humans. It doesn't spread to deer, right?
No. It's not deer to deer. It's not deer to humans. I don't know what the vector is. But it kills them fast when they contract it. It's like a 36-hour death.
Huh.
Not good.
So there is that. And what else? Tree planting season for some people. If you like fall planting, which which we do with the Catskill Forest Association when we're not here on WIOX. So, yeah, I just planted a magnolia tree last week.
Cool.
I love planting in the fall. It's a good time. Killed the grass for 2 months, and, you know, there's no grass, thick grass to compete with the tree roots.
Nice. Yeah. I planted 2 peach trees about, I guess it was 3 weeks ago. Wasn't quite fall yet, but.
Yeah. Nice.
Yep. They were just a roadside tree, and I don't know, there was 24 to pick through, and there was 2 that were looked gorgeous. They were pruned perfectly, and they were healthy and vigorous, so I took those 2. The rest of the pile didn't look so good.
Yeah, peaches, you know, they should start fruiting year 1, year 2.
Yeah, I'm excited for that.
So, had a lot of grapes this year.
Really?
My white grapes, or green grapes, did really well, and I can't complain about that.
Nice. I picked some Concord grapes on Catskill Forest Association members' property this weekend. Yeah.
I think these are Niagara, maybe. Yeah, I think they're Niagara grapes.
They have seeds?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I love them. I like them. They're good. My Yellow Delicious, I think, is the best apple I got. So that thing really bared some fruit this year.
Wow.
So that was good. Other than that, I'm just watching trees grow. So, you know, got a sycamore in the front that's exploding, and hopefully that continues. But I took that sycamore from, just ripped it out of the ground 3 years ago.
Yeah?
2 years ago. Yeah. I was like, this will never work. It rooted. Must have had a root, one root, little hair root on it.
Was it just, did it grow right away, or was it lagging for a while?
It didn't die back. It just, you know, sat there. But, yeah, it's a cool tree. I like them.
Nice.
And that's about it. But I'm just about out of deer meat. I am out of deer meat, and that means hunting season's coming, and finishing up the last hide to make into leather. So hunting season must be soon, you know?
Oh, it's coming. But you mentioned you don't like going out opening day.
No, I mean, when I first got into bow hunting, it was like the third Saturday or the Saturday after Columbus Day or something.
Yeah, it was still that when I was getting into bow hunting, too.
Yeah.
The first Saturday after Columbus Day.
Now, don't get me wrong, I like the option, that October 1st. I think it makes sense, but it's just too warm, and the deer don't move as much. You know, they are crepuscular, and they move at dawn and dusk for the most part, and since most of my time is left for hunting in the evening, they really don't move till the dark. There's just so much more action with the bucks chasing does in the last week of October, first 2 weeks of November, so I put my time into then.
Yeah. I don't know. I've learned more to try to target a doe early. I've been successful doing that the last couple of years, and for me, it takes a little pressure off. It's like, then when that, you know, the late October, early November comes, I could focus on a buck if I want to go do that.
Well, I got 2 doe tags for rifle season, so.
You lucky person. You know, this is the first time I haven't gotten 2 doe tags in like 3 years. Yet everybody around me, they've all gotten them.
I haven't gotten 2 doe tags in a while. It's been some years.
Well, so good. I hope you use them.
No, I'll use one of them. Yeah, not unless it happens last year. I think last year was a fluke. Just the bucks were running so much, I couldn't resist.
Yeah.
You know, just too many of them around.
Well, my second doe tag that I got, it's not even for around here. It's not even the Catskills. I have to travel to Finger Lakes to go fill that one, so we'll see.
Yeah, give you something to do.
Yeah, it's opportunistic if I'm out Thanksgiving time or something and hunt my family out there.
Yeah. So, last week I missed the radio show. I was out in the woods, and I guess Gary Mead was on.
Yep.
Talking about bark.
Talked about tree bark. Gary had some stories. It seems like he's done more than most with tree bark in a sawmill.
Yeah.
Most people, that's a byproduct they're looking to get rid of, and Gary's using it, and it's awesome. He's going to side his whole house with trees.
Yeah. I use the bark to tan leather. That's about it, and hemlock bark is excellent for it, but that's about my only experience with it.
Yeah. I don't have many at all. I enjoyed listening to Gary because he had some stories. Let me tell you, he's using shagbark hickory even.
Shagbark hickory?
Yeah, not for siding.
Used shagbark hickory. I've eaten it. It made a tea out of it. If you add sugar, you can make hickory syrup. There's a guy who sells it commercially online.
Really?
I read about it years ago and tried it, and it's not bad. You know, but when you make maple syrup, man.
I was going to say, so it wasn't worth doing twice, so.
Maple syrup's the best. Yeah. You know, people come out with all this black walnut syrup and birch. No, I'm a maple snob.
So gave out maple syrup for our wedding favors 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, John got married. Believe this?
Yeah, that happened. Well, anyway, we gave out some wedding favors, and one of the guests there is part of a large syrup operation.
Yeah.
Family has 100,000 taps.
Yeah.
And I got compliments on it, so made me feel good.
Yeah, that's a 100,000 taps, huh?
He couldn't believe that it didn't go through a filter press. He was so clear. I said, that's just...
Yeah.
I guess it's just good stuff.
Yeah. Yeah, last year was a good year. I didn't make a tremendous amount, but it was good quality, so... I don't know, have it every morning, you know? So, in any case, for my wedding, we gave out maple peanuts.
Oh, man, you treated people.
Yeah, that was the wedding favor.
Nice.
About 2 to 4 ounces or 4 ounces maybe of, maybe it was 9, I don't remember. But everyone got maple peanuts, man.
Nice. You made them?
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. No, that was fun. You know, so that's what I bring on me with my trip. And every year for the last 14 years, I've been going on this trip. Actually, it's 16 years. But about 14 years, I started doing it, like a through hike. And it started when I was working for CFA in 2007. I got bored and I was staring at the map and decided maybe I'd walk from Markville to where I grew up in New Paltz. So, and just go right through the woods, you know, hardly any trails. I wanted to hit up as many streams as I could, brook trout fish and all that, and some brown trout, and walk all the way to Shangham Ridge over where I grew up and cross over the Rondout Valley and end in the Walkhill Valley. And it's pretty neat. And that was the trip I did for probably, 5 to 7 years.
So that's basically traversing the entire Catskills, west to east.
The whole park. The high peaks.
The whole high peak region.
Yeah, because when you start in Margaretville, you're on the very north side of the park or the high peaks. And then you basically walk over 3A or Slide Mountain Wilderness area. And you come out in Sampsonville, which is how I found where I live. I liked it over there, and I said, you know what? I like it over there, and that's I stuck around. But and then you got one more ridge, the Shangham Ridge. You got to cross over the Rondout Valley and go up and over, and it's pretty neat. You know, it's pretty cool after being in the woods. Back then, I used to stay in the woods like anywhere from 4 nights to 6 nights. And when you're in the woods for that long and you come upon a cow track, it's kind of cool. You come out into the sunlight because the woods is dark in Slide Mountain Wilderness.
Yeah,
you know? It's just one big canopy, man. And when you come out into, the big Rondout Valley, it's kind of a nice change, you know? Hearing more birds and stuff like that. Cow track?
What is this?
Wow. Yeah. But, yeah.
So, do you run into people in 6 days?
In the Rondout Valley, you do. You know? And it's kind of cool. When you're walking around as a person that they don't know, you get to be a more objective judge of the culture. And people are kind of nice. You know? People would offer you rides. And I remember I was in Accord, and one guy was like, if you need a place to stay and stuff, you know, you clean your clothes. I was like, Jesus Christ, no, I'm all right.
Wow.
I mean, I was surprised. Yeah, people offer you water. And so that was good, you know. Yeah, so, and I looked pretty ragged, you know. Clothes are all scuffed up. I mean, you don't look clean or anything.
Right. I mean, do you bring more than one change of clothes in a 6-day walk?
Yeah, two shirts, a bunch of two sweaters, two pairs of socks. You know, and a hat, because at night it gets cold up on the mountain.
Especially this last weekend, right?
Yeah, well, I used to do it in July, so that was stupid. I did it in July because the days were longer, and I figured I could cover more territory and take my time and fish, which makes sense, because it wouldn't get dark till like 8:30,
mm-hmm.
You know, 9 o'clock almost.
Right.
It's just so hot. I mean, you go up like German Hollow. I used to begin on the Drybrook Ridge, and it's just, you can feel your heart beating through your... through your clothes. It's just hot. It's 90 degrees out, and you're going up that hill and bushwhacking up a slope, and it's just unnecessary. It's a full pack too, and you know, I wouldn't pack that light because I brought my fishing rod and stuff. I wanted to
wanted to enjoy the time you had, so you brought some items.
I wasn't hiking the Appalachian Trail, you know, where you want to like pack no more than 30 pounds, 20 pounds even.
Right.
So no, it's a 50 to 60 pound pack. So I did bring stuff, And so I'm more of a fair weather camper now. I just kind of put aside kind of 2 weeks in September. It kept pushing back. It used to be the 4th of July weekend. And then it became August. And then it became September. And I think September's my favorite month to be out in the woods as far as just chilling out.
Why is that, other than weather? I mean, weather's the biggest factor, right?
August, it starts to cool off at night, but September, it's almost always cool at night. It never gets that warm, and if it does, it's going to cool off real fast. You get those first hints of fall. The only bad thing is it's not as long, but the days are still long. I mean, it gets dark at 7:30, you know? It's not terrible.
Right, it's an hour less, that's all.
Yeah, whereas in the winter, it's dark by 4:45, you know? And it's like, okay, now it's cold, one, and two, it's like you have 12 hours until the sun comes up again, you right, know? 14 yeah. hours, you know? It's like, that's a long time. It's a long time when it's dark out, you know? And you're alone.
And you don't, yeah, so what do you do? Yeah. I mean, I'm sure you're tired and you go to bed after you have a little campfire.
I get the fire going now, which I never did before. I mean, I never used to have a fire, but now I get a fire going and... you know, smoke some cigars, listen. I bring a pocket radio, you know.
Okay.
Yeah, I used to be a purist and be like, okay, I have any technology. It's like, no. I listen to my tunes. I got AM radio, FM radio. I bring a magazine, not a book, because most books are too big. I don't feel like carrying them. So just a magazine of my preference. And, you know, yeah. Try. But, you know, the trip used to be 4 to 6 nights. Now, from doing that through hike from Margaretville to Gardner or New Paltz, I've come to realize there's only a few places that I really like a lot on that trip, and that's where I go now. And plus, I have family now, and I can't really justify going away for 4 nights or 6 nights. I already feel like a dirt bag as it is going away for 2 nights and leaving my wife with 4 kids.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, it's not good. So, yeah, I pick 2 nights, and I go to the two places that I love the most, and one is on top of a mountain and the other is down by my favorite stream, and that's the best of both worlds. So,
all right.
So yeah, that's changed a lot. And
so right. How far did you walk, I guess, as the crow flies, and how far do you go now?
I can tell you exactly. I mean, the first day is only about 3 to 4 miles bushwhacking. It's all bushwhacking. There's no trails.
Of what you used to do or what you
did? Oh, what I used to do?
Yeah.
Well, shoot, I mean, from Arkville to New Paltz isn't as far as people think, but it's probably about 30 miles through the woods. It's okay. About 4 ridges, one big valley and another ridge. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
And now how?
Because think about it. When you're in Arkville, you go up and over, so you go up the Dry Brook, you go up and over that one ridge, and you're in Frost Valley, right? You go up and over Wildcat. And you're in East Branch, Neversink. You go up and over that ridge, you're in the Rondeau. You go up and over the next one, you're in the Rondeau Valley.
Right.
It's not that far as you think.
Yeah, it's an hour and 45-minute drive if you're going to do all that.
Yeah, it's a long drive. But, you know, the ridges became – I used to be all about going up mountains, but what happened was now the mountains are kind of impediments to get the streams, and I'm all about the streams now. The streams are more enticing and stuff. But the one thing I will say is about streams, though, that I've realized, when you camp near a stream, after a while, it kind of is deafening. Like, I love about my second night, I'm always camped out on a stream. When you walk away from it, you're like, Jesus, it's quiet. I mean, and the stream makes weird noises at night. You know, you can hear rocks in there moving along the stream bed. And they make noises that almost sound like, I mean, I know they're not. I don't get scared of them, but they sound, they have their own world, their own sound to stream, you know, and it's a pretty loud stream. You hear things, you know, you're like, what the heck? You know, it's nothing, you know, but.
Yeah.
But up on the ridge is really quiet in September. So that's the other bad thing about camping in September as opposed to July. July, as soon as the sun even thinks about coming up, the birds are like all over the place. But when you wake up in August above 3,000 feet in the Catskill Mountains, it is quiet as anything.
So that's...
It's quiet. Yeah, it's kind of lonely.
I was going to say that. It's almost... it takes away a little bit.
In September, it's done. But the cool thing is, where my campsite is, I can hear the katydids down below, even though I'm at, you know, 3,300 feet. You can hear them at 800 below, the katydids at night, and that's kind of neat.
Yeah.
You know. But if you're just tuning in, you're listening to From the Forest every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m. And tonight's topic about my my little trip in the woods last week.
Now when you're sitting there in your silk upholstery chair, talking to some rich folks that you know, well, I hope you don't see me in my ragged company. All that you know, I could never be alone. Take me down, little Susie, take me down. I know you think you're the queen of the underground. Send me dead flowers every morning. Send me dead flowers by the maid. Send me dead flowers to my wedding, and I won't forget to put roses on your grave. Well, now when you're sitting back in your rose pink Cadillac, making bets on Kentucky Derby days, I'll be in my basement room with a needle and a spoon, and another girl to take my pain away. Take me down, little Susie, take me down. I know you think you're the queen of the underground. Send me dead flowers every morning. Send me dead flowers by the maid. Send me dead flowers to my wedding, and I won't forget to put roses on your grave. No, I won't forget to put roses on your grave.
All right. If you're just tuning in, you're listening to From the Forest every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m. Talk about a different forest-related topic with Ryan and John. Tonight's topic is Ryan's walk in the woods last week. Just a few days out there, nothing crazy. But so this takes place in a very rugged area of the Catskill Mountains, most remote in the Catskills for sure. And this is a solo trip, so there's certain things that you kind of have to think about when you're hiking alone. And the older I get, the more I think about them.
Yeah? So what's changed in your pack in the last 10 years?
Well, there's different things like I bring more first aid kit stuff, you know.
Have you ever had an incident where you needed like a legit kit rather
No.
Just a band-aid?
But, you know, you always think to yourself, you know, what if I sprain my ankle or something or slip, fall? Yeah. You know, I've been out there and I wanted to see like this. I remember this is rock shelter and it was kind of cool. So I was like, oh, it's probably a view up there. And I'm climbing up there. And this is like in the middle of nowhere. This is literally the most remote area. And I'm on the side of this cliff and I'm like, this is a few years back. So just so you know, this is. And also I'm like, what the hell am I doing? Man, if I get hurt here,
no one's finding you.
No one's going to find. I mean, no one. I'm screwed. So I bring a whistle. Bring two headlamps. I used to bring only one. I have bring a firearm, so that's good. This year I brought bear spray.
No firearm, huh?
No, I brought.
You did as well.
Yeah, brought both. Bear spray is hard to get, by the way. Didn't realize that. Won't ship it to you in New York State.
What?
No, they will not ship it to you. So I had to go to Kenco and buy it.
How does Kenco get it?
I don't know.
They must ship it to them.
They must have some license or something.
Huh, interesting.
But or whatever, just like pesticides, you know. I don't know. Actually, you can ship pesticides as long as you're an applicator, right? But I don't know. So I had that going on because I have had an incident, and we've talked about it before and from the forest, and if we get to it, maybe we'll talk about it. But I've had a bear incident where a bear did come at me, and it was not a female. It was a male, and I did not appreciate it. And I was in the middle of nowhere, and I don't want to be in that position again, John.
And you didn't have a firearm then.
And I didn't have a firearm. I didn't have pepper spray. And I realized black bears are the most friendliest of all the bears. But you know what? When one's looking at you like it wants to kick your butt, it's different.
Yeah, I can't imagine.
and you're only facing each other out of stream that's only 5 yards apart. It's different.
Yeah. So there's two incidents where one would have found you.
Yeah, so that was just ridiculous. So since then, I don't take a chance. But basically, the first thing is getting in shape. And, you know, I walk all the time on the road, but walking with a pack on is completely different. Walking with a heavy pack on is even more different. And when I used to be an assistant forest ranger for the DEC, it was, you know, I was already in shape for that. Your tendons, everything have to get used to that. Your muscles, of course, but everything's got to get used to that. And so I start doing that about a month before, start hiking with a pack on, and start adding weight, and gradually, and that works out. So you have to have a certain pack for bushwhacking. You can't have like one of those high packs, like for like hiking in this high Sierras or something where there's no vegetation, because otherwise
you get
pulled down all the time, man. So you need a lower pack. Nothing should be over your head. You know, otherwise you're just going to be really mad the whole time.
Sure, yeah, I've seen those frame packs you're talking about. You know, you go to order one, those are the first ones you're going to find when you research.
Yeah, I bought a pack years ago, and it's awesome. It really is. And I can fit. It breaks down, compresses to a day pack, and expands to a week-long pack. You can hold supposedly pieces of elk in it. But I haven't done that, but it's pretty crazy. So, yeah, there's all sorts of stuff I bring. I used to bring just a bivy sack, and I've decided I don't feel like doing that anymore because you can't move, and I'm not that minimalist anymore. I want to enjoy myself. It's supposed to be fun a little bit. So I went to a two-man tent, and now I'm back at a one-man tent. So I like these one-man tents. They make some really light ones.
Yeah.
It weighs just about the same as a bivy sack, and, yeah, just in case it rains or whatever.
Cool.
So they're cool. You know, you bring toilet paper, two headlamps, as I said, matches, waterproof. I bring propane stove.
What do you have, like a little like jet boil stove?
Yeah, pocket rocket, MSR. I've had that for 16 years. Thing's awesome. Titanium cup, Nalgene water bottle with a filter. It screws right onto the Nalgene bottle. It's awesome. Bear string for hanging your food. It's also kind of challenging. I don't use a GPS. I use a map and compass with an altimeter. And just kind of challenge, and it's fun. It's fun to do, and it keeps me kind of paying attention in different ways. I kind of like.
Do you ever find yourself wondering, even though you're pretty confident where you are, do you ever find yourself wondering, maybe I'm not exactly where I should be?
Yeah. Now that I've done this trip many times, not as much, I will say in the last few years, I have it marked now on a GPS, but I didn't use it this year. 3 years ago when I wasn't paying attention, it's always when you get lazy.
Yeah.
I walked past where the campsite was somehow and was like, what the hell? But that was a long time ago. But what usually happens is with a compass, is, and I've learned the hard way, is you're not trusting your equipment. You're not paying attention. But having an altimeter is amazing. I mean, because if you hit a stream and you know you're on that stream, you can exactly pinpoint where you are on the map. So I have an ABC watch, you know, and it does altimeter, barometer, and compass, and they're really accurate. I've checked it. I didn't trust it at first, so I was bringing a second altimeter and checking it with a GPS. Nah, that thing's within 50 to 100 feet is fine. It's pretty good, actually. So
cool.
Yeah, so you can pinpoint where you are, and if you pay attention to the contours, you can kind of figure out where you are, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, as long as you're paying attention to any type of feature, like if, a saddle or the bank's dropping off steep, you can figure that out on a map usually. Yeah. I learned that once. Man, this one spot at deer hunt, I know that one saddle, like the back of my hand, when there's no leaves on. I went up there for the first time.
Different.
When it was, it's beech.
It's totally different.
It's totally thick, and
yeah.
It's not even that big of a saddle between these two ridges, and I knew where the trail was because I knew what side of the saddle I was on. I knew the shape of the saddle, so I knew if I just went straight up and over, I'd hit the trail.
Yep.
But, man, it was a heck of a lot further, and I was second-guessing myself. By the end, I was like, maybe I did get turned around.
Totally. And GPS is definitely a benefit when you're hunting, because when you're hunting, you're not paying attention to your map as much. You're hopefully looking for game, right?
Yeah, right.
Deer. I got messed up 2 years ago in the same area where I camp, and I knew it could happen. I looked at the map, and I said, if I don't pay attention, I'm going to follow this ridge and contour out on this ridge instead of cutting back to the truck.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, I look over, and I'm like, that's the wrong side of High Point I'm looking at, and I'm looking at the Ashokan now, reservoir. I'm like, I'm screwed up. And I had to go back up, lose all my elevation, then gain it all back. It's a pain in the ass.
Yeah.
You know, but because you're hunting, you know, you're looking at stuff, and
yep,
that's when you get messed up.
Definitely know how that can happen.
So, yeah, the compass is more difficult to really look at while you're hunting, and I think that's why it's become more popular with hunters, you know.
The GPS.
Yeah.
Yeah. Our group has them, and our group has one that can communicate with each other, so we actually know where each other is at.
Yeah.
On the same GPS screen, so that's really helpful when especially when somebody doesn't really know the lay of the land like you might.
Yeah. But what's cool, I guess you could do it on GPS, is my map is starting to come together a little bit. Like I find charcoal here and oak here, and I'm starting to see where there's a lot more forest fires than I thought up there in the middle of the high peaks.
So you write it down on your map?
Yeah, I write it down, and they're starting to connect. And I'm like, this whole area is burned, man.
Huh.
And this is like, there's hardly any oaks. I mean, there's a few oaks, but some areas are completely maple, which you don't think of fire in maple woods, but finding more and more of it, and I think it dates back, if I had to guess, to the bark shanty days of tan barking and stuff, you know, where they're leaving all those logs on the ground.
Hemlock brush burning, maybe?
Absolutely. So, something like that, but
What do you bring for food?
Food. Yeah, I don't get crazy, so what I bring for food is, I tell you exactly, it's 2 nights, 3 days. So I always bring a pound of maple peanuts. which is awesome because before I made maple syrup, when I was a ranger, I brought peanuts and M&M, peanut butter M&Ms. And what you end up doing then is you end up high-grading all the maple peanuts.
Yeah.
Then you just left the peanuts, and that sucks. But anyway, now I make maple syrup and maple peanuts. You know, it's like maple-coated peanuts, and it has the right amount of salt, fat, and carbohydrate, and it's just awesome.
So just quick energy.
So a pound of those. But this time I added some cashews, which is really nice. I like having some cashews in there. Then I bring 2 blocks of cheese, 3 tortilla wraps, big tortilla wraps, 1 rice packet, and pepperoni stick. That's it. Yeah.
Are you pretty hungry at the end of this?
No, it's perfect amount.
That's perfect amount.
No, after 15 years, that's it. No extra food, really. I mean, I literally, and then I fish. So I caught a brook trout and I cooked them up with in the rice.
Okay.
Because I'm only eating the rice. The first night, I don't have water nearby, so I'm not going to make rice.
Okay.
The second night, I'm near a stream, and I have all the water I want because I have a filter.
So what, do you just cook the rice and make like a cheesy rice burrito?
No cheese. Is that what the
tortilla's for?
No, that's for lunch. I just add the trout, cut them up, and put them into the rice. But during lunch, I just have – this is going to sound crazy, but –
yeah, whatever.
It's whatever. I take a wrap. I cut up slices of pepperoni and cheese. And some of it's fancy cheese because I'm figuring, what the hell? I don't care.
Sure.
And with the maple peanuts, make a wrap out of it.
You had me till the peanuts.
And I love it. I have grown to love this damn sandwich.
Yeah. No, I would be down for that until the peanuts came along.
This maple coat of peanuts, man. That's hey, right. Don't knock it until you try it.
Sure.
I don't know. I used to have smoked kielbasa with me, or like venison kielbasa, but I don't go to Veteran anymore. You know, the smokehouse of the Catskills, they had the best kielbasa. So, but I don't know. I love it. I don't want to be spending all my time cooking and stuff, so
yeah,
I just put it together. Yeah.
Cool. I like that.
Yeah.
Very portioned.
Yeah, absolutely. Bring extra bootlaces, you know. I've had bootlaces break out in the woods, and it's like you think your bootlaces are always going to last, right? Because they normally do. Every day you get up, you pull on them, and they work. But as soon as you're out in the woods, you just rip them off. So I always bring extra bootlaces or 550 cord. 550 cord is one of the best things to bring.
Yeah,
that's
versatile for everything, right?
Yeah, absolutely. I have a rifle. I have stuff to kill a bear with. So string, I have a gutting tool and all that, just in case, because it is bear hunting season when I'm out there.
So you could.
I don't really care to, but this year, actually, I was actually looking for them a little bit because it was cool at night.
Ah.
And
yeah, you could have dealt with it, actually.
It got down to freezing, and it was like, you know what, this could happen, but...
Would have ruined your trip, though, as far as the purpose of your trip, because now you have to deal with a bear. But
I'd have to hike out in the night.
That's a positive thing.
Yep, I'd have to hike out in the night. So, if you're just tuning in, you're listening to From the Forest every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m., and tonight we're talking about Ryan's walk in the woods.
Standing on the corner at midnight, trying to get my courage up. There was this long, lovely dancing little club downtown. Loved to watch her do her stuff. Through the long she filled my sleep. My body softly swaying to that smoky beat down on Main Street. Down on Main Street. In the pool halls, a hustle.
hustlers and the losers. Used to watch them through the glass. Well, I'd stand outside at closing time just to watch her walk on past. Unlike all the other ladies, she looked so young and sweet. She made her way along down that empty street, down on Main Street. Main Street.
Okay, if you're just tuning in, you're listening to From the Forest every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m. Talk about a different forest-related topic with Ryan and John. Tonight's topic is Ryan's walk in the woods. I wasn't here last week because, well, I was in the woods. Just on a couple nights, 3 days, over there in high peaks of the Catskill Mountains, having some fun. So we're talking about, a gear list, and that's probably one of the most challenging things of doing any trip, is just knowing what to bring. And what I also bring for clothing is one rain jacket, a pack rain cover. I used to have everything in my pack used to be in plastic bags. And you have to get the air out, right, so it fits. But the company that makes the pack, they make a rain cover for it. It's awesome. Now you have to worry about that, you know. It really is. I think that's one of the best things I started doing. Because when I used to have a Kelty bag, I didn't have a pack cover for it. It was a pain, man.
I can imagine when just walking through like a dewy morning and any type of beach brush or anything like that.
Yeah.
Even if it's not raining, you're going to get soaked.
That's right. So that's no good. Sleeping, Therm-a-Rest, not a full one, but a 3/4 Therm-a-Rest.
What is that?
It goes up to like your knees.
Like
it's as long as like your knees. No, it keeps it. You blow it up, and it keeps you off the ground.
Oh, otherwise a pad, you mean?
Yeah. Otherwise, your heat is you're just losing all your heat to the ground.
Gotcha.
Makes a huge difference.
Okay.
And they're very light. I've had mine for 16 years.
Is your tent that you use like a full sidewall tent? I know some of those one person ones just have like a 3-side like a with a cover on top.
Yeah, it has a fly that goes on the top and it opens on one side. It's basically a glorified bivy sack with two little tent poles, on one near your feet and one near your head.
Right. But so you're exposed. You're outside.
You're outside, but the fly goes up and over. No, it goes over the whole thing.
Oh, okay.
If you want it to.
Gotcha.
Yeah. You know, I didn't need it to. I had it open to breathe. One thing about bivy sacks or any tent, really, they need to breathe. Otherwise, you're getting condensation, especially in a bivy sack.
Mm-hmm.
You'll end up waking it even on a dry night. Soaked, because water is condensing on the side of it, which, you know, isn't the biggest deal in the fall, but in the wintertime, it's a big deal.
Oh, yeah.
And the condensation can build up to where you wake up at night and there is water running down the bottom of the tent. And if you have a down sleeping bag that loses its loft when moisture hits it,
you're done.
And it's 10 degrees outside, that's bad.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah, I've been there. So, yeah, we talked about the food, but cheese, meat, you know, pepperoni, they go a long way, man. So, but yeah, we can talk a little bit about day one, you know, just things to see. And day one, I basically get out of the truck, set a bearing up to where I'm going. Basically, I'm trying to get to a stream. Once I get to the stream, then I just walk up to the stream until it runs out. Then I know my elevation. I set another bearing and go to the campsite from there. But it's amazing. There's skid roads even up there at 2,800 feet in elevation. So, you know, the you're basically starting where the farms used to be, going up to where they used to log, and then it's first growth where they never, no one ever did anything. So once you get above 3,000 feet, it's no human influence really ever. So kind of a weird thing. And the vegetation starts with northern hardwoods on some of the steep ridges. Actually, there's oak and some laurel in places where fires probably burned once upon a time. Well, I know there's fire because there's charcoal on the forest floor. A lot of stinging nettle in places, but really not much growing on the forest floor other than some beech. And actually, there's black birch growing, unfortunately, near the stream because the hemlocks are dying so much. A lot of maple actually coming in, I was surprised to see. But a lot of black birch and the hemlocks in this one area are really getting their butts kicked by woolly adelgid. Maybe elongate hemlock scale too, but woolly adelgid, so that stinks. Bear sign, there's bear sign everywhere up there. I mean, there's just so much bear sign. It's a little crazy, actually. No ginseng.
You didn't see any bears, though?
I didn't see any bears. Usually I almost always see a bear or hear a bear. A lot of times they sound like thunder through the woods trying to get away from you.
Yep.
So, you know, you surprise them. Emerald ash borer, big time. Even up in the middle of nowhere, on top of the mountains, these trees are dead. They not only have emerald ash borer, they're just dead. So, yeah, remote areas, hey, they're not that remote if you fly.
Like right.
right?
And no ginseng.
No ginseng, and I look for it. I have never seen ginseng in this area, and I think the browse pressure is too high. And I know that they eat ginseng. I'm not going to blame poachers because there's no sugar maple up there either regenerating, and no one's picking sugar maple. So that tells you something. On top is a boreal forest. It's like being back at school, at the ranger school in the Adirondacks. It's mountain paper birch and hobble bush. And balsam fir and red spruce, stuff like that.
Wow. And what elevation are we now?
3,300.
Wow.
But exposed. And it's solid. Solid spruce fir.
And that's where you camp out?
Yeah. Yeah, it's a cool spot. And, you know, it faces kind of southeast.
Any views?
Oh, yeah.
You can see.
Yeah, I could see big time. Nice. I could see the Rhinecliff Bridge. And, oh, yeah. Cool. See Mohonk and High Point, and then some. Yeah, I can almost see my house from there. But, yeah, it's pretty neat. But, you know, you're looking down at, like, 800 feet. I mean, literally.
Yeah.
So that's pretty neat. Well, I think the coolest wildlife thing I saw, actually, was watching hawks this year. I watched a hawk in the distance search out that thermal, and it was a hawk. It wasn't a buzzard. And he found it, went up, thousands of feet above where I was, and then downplaned to the next valley. And I was like, that's pretty cool. I watched him doing that.
Effortlessly, never flapped.
Yeah.
It's awesome.
Yeah, that was pretty neat. There was quite a few of them this year. Usually I don't see it. I don't know. I don't remember seeing them that much.
Well, maybe you're hitting some type of migratory time since you're moving your times around a little bit.
Yeah. That's pretty cool. You know, I feel like it was late this year for foliage. I mean, there was no foliage up there. I mean, it was last week.
Right.
I'm above 3,000 feet. Usually the yellow birches are changing. But yeah, nothing.
Yeah, I didn't think of that. Yeah.
Yeah. Nothing. I figured, once I got above 2,500 feet, you know, no. So, I don't know. Whatever. I can't remember what it was like that much. But I feel like last year I was seeing some yellow birch changing already. So, what else? Second day, to set a bearing again and go downhill towards the main stream. It's pretty cool because you run into this little pocket, about a half-acre stand of old-growth hemlock. And, I mean, they are big and old.
How big? Like diameter?
Oh, they got to be more than 40 inches.
Wow.
You know, 50 maybe. Just gigantic, though. Big crowns, middle of nowhere, very rugged area. This year, I changed my bearing a little and wanted to go down the ridge instead of that steepness area. And ran into, I never knew it was there, old growth sugar maple. Beautiful, beautiful timber. Really nice.
Cool.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, it's something unique.
Yeah, didn't know it was there. And that was pretty cool to see. And in this area, which is it's known for, is really old growth, yellow birch and black cherry. And the black cherry, yellow birch are so old, they fool you. Because when yellow birch gets older, it goes from golden papery bark to looking like a black cherry.
Yeah, it gets blocky looking.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Metamorphosizes.
Some of those just below the top of the ridge where I hunt.
Yeah.
Yeah. I don't really like getting into there because I know if I'm seeing those yellow birch, it's not fun to get out of where I am for where I need to be.
Hey, you know, I don't know why people don't talk about it more, but if you need to start a fire, nothing to me works better than yellow birch bark.
Yeah.
It's better than paper birch bark.
Like oil in there that just crackles right up.
I mean, getting a fire going. It was damp the first day, even though it didn't rain. It was still damp. No problems.
Good.
With that yellow birch bark. That stuff's the best. That's down by the stream, and there's some brook trout down there. Totally different. I mean, it's hemmed in. There's no view, but there's the stream, and it's just a different feeling. And that's, you know, that's below 2,000 feet now. But the last day, I hike up and over the ridge back to the truck, and on top was an old farm, which is pretty neat. And there's an old red oak I always stop at, and it's a pretty big red oak. And it must have been all by its lonesome back in the day, time ago. And I'm thinking this tree's got to be well over 150 years old. So it's, you know, Civil War era kind of stuff.
Wow.
Pretty neat, you know. Half of it's now starting to die. But it's still raining down acorns like crazy. And the ground is smooth in this area.
How high up?
It's about 2,400 feet.
That's high for a farm, right?
Yeah. Yeah, wow. This is one of the most remote farm areas I can think of. And they must have been plowing, because that's why the ground is kind of smooth on top, because they were plowing them rocks up.
Any stone walls or no?
Oh, yeah. Stone walls and rocks where they were throwing them, because when you plow, the rocks rise to the top through freezing and stuff, and they throw them again. So there's both.
Wow.
Yeah, crazy, crazy. You know, yeah, I've said this before on the radio show. I was up there 3 years ago, and opening day of hunting season, I think it was 2 or 3 years ago. Remember, it was like in the 70s?
Yeah, it was longer ago than that. Cause it
was it?
Snowed the next day.
Snowed the next day, like 8 to 10 inches or something.
Yeah. More where I was. Yeah, it was like 18 where I was. It's crazy.
And I was up at that spot leaning on a stone wall, and I was just thinking to myself, man, can you imagine being these people not having weather forecasts and outside and thinking, man, this is great, not knowing that a 10-inch storm is coming their way.
Third weekend in November, it's 70-degree and T-shirt weather, and the next day we're going to get dumped.
Yeah, absolutely. So, you know, that's something. The other thing is, I always bring a walking stick. I highly recommend it, you know, keeps your footing, stuff like that. I used to bring hiking poles, but turns out the woods is loaded with hiking sticks.
Yeah.
So.
Who knew?
Yeah, who knew? But that's about it. You know, I get home and then I you got to dry out everything, you know? Take everything out and make sure it's completely dry before you put it back, you know?
Well, it sounds like your trip has evolved a lot. Is there anything you want to change for next year?
Next year, no. I think, I'm going to go to a slightly different place the second night. But no, not really. I like the trip, you know.
Not about what you change or what you bring with you, though?
No.
You think you got it nailed down?
Yeah, no, that was good. I think I continue to do that.
Good.
Yeah. Yeah, there's always, like, There's always something you could bring, but
yeah, know. you could pick some leeks and put it in. In that rice you make.
I could, if you find them. You got to really look for them that time of year because there's no leaves.
Well, the seed heads are popping up now, though.
The seed heads are, yeah.
Yeah, if you know where to look in that sugar maple stand, you should see some seeds popping up and just dig them up.
You know, there's not many leeks in that area.
No.
Not as many as you think.
Huh.
Yeah. I don't know. If I find them, I'd pick them. Yeah, it's a good idea. I saw a chicken in the woods mushroom, but I didn't pick it. I didn't want to carry it. I feel like carrying it.
Yeah, they're heavy if you carry a lot of it.
Yeah. I used to pick them more. And then, you know, but it's like, I don't know. It's just one more thing to do, you know?
Right.
And
you didn't go there to work on stuff.
No. And you already have the fire. Oh, I bring a silky saw with me. I mean, you got to bring.
Yeah.
Yeah. Cut up some wood. Some down wood. Those things are so sharp. They're awesome. But other than that, no, I think it was good. You know, the problem people run into, too, is the bigger the pack you bring into the woods, the more you're prone to bring with you. So
keep your pack small, and if you can't fit, it's not going.
Yeah. Or, you know, be cognizant of it, you know, and try to, limit it. But, it's weight, man. You don't want to bring too much weight with you.
I know. I packed in a tree stand once to a spot that I'm never going with a tree stand again. Don't know what I was thinking.
Yeah.
Killed me. And that's normally a hike that I can just hop, skip right up there.
It's different with a pack on. Totally. It's completely different. But, it's about all we got on From the Forest. And if you're just tuning in, it's every Wednesday, 6 to 7 p.m. And we're talking about a trip in the woods. I'd say the hardest part about doing a trip in the woods is just planning for it, really. You know, doing it isn't too bad.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I was listening to a hunting podcast just yesterday, and they talked about just getting ready for your trip is going to make or break it. You know, if you're feeling rushed the whole time, your trip's not going to be any different.
Yeah, I packed my pack 2 nights before.
Yeah.
So because I figure I'm going to forget something, and then the night I have 2 days to think about it.
Yeah, so that's pretty much what they were saying.
Yep, I agree. I concur. So that's all we got, and see you next week.
All right, good night, everyone.
Oh, the neon lights were flashing and the icy wind did blow. The water seeped into his shoes and the drizzle turned to snow. His eyes were red, his hopes were dead, and the wine was running low. And the old man came home from the forest. His tears fell on the sidewalk as he stumbled in the street. A dozen faces stopped to stare, but no one stopped to speak. For his castle was a hallway, and the bottle was his friend. And the old man stumbled in from the forest. Up a dark and dingy staircase, the old man made his way. His ragged coat around him as upon his cot he lay. And he wondered how it happened that he'd ended up this way. Getting lost like a fool in the forest. And as he lay there sleeping, a vision did appear. Upon his mantle shining, the face of one so dear, who'd loved him in the springtime of a long-forgotten year, when the wildflowers did bloom in the forest. She touched his grizzled fingers and she called him by his name. And then he heard the joyful sound of children at their games. In an old house on a hillside in some forgotten town, where the river runs down from the forest. Jet soars above.
never sleeps, and to an old forgotten soul.